Welcome to the lecture of Introduction to Python. In this lecture, we are going to see what data science is in brief. We are also going to look at what are the commonly used tools for data science. We will also look at the history of Python, and followed by that, we'll look at what an IDE means. So we live in a world that's drowning with data. Wherever we go, wherever we are, data is getting generated from various sources. Now, when you browse through a few websites, the websites track every user's click, and this forms a part of web analytics. The other instance of where data gets generated is when you use a smartphone. You are basically building up a record of your location. So all these information go and sit somewhere and get collected in the form of data. We also have sensors from electronic devices that record real-time information, and you also have e-commerce websites that collect purchasing habits. So whenever you log into any of these e-commerce sites, you will see some recommendations based on your previous purchase history or previous view history. So now let's see what data science is all about. So it is an interdisciplinary field that brings together computer science, statistics and mathematics to get useful inferences and insights from a data. Now these insights are very crucial from a business perspective because it will help you in making better business decisions. Now currently there are many tools that are being used in data science. Now these tools can be bucketed into three categories. The first category is where you are going to be looking at data pre-processing and analysis. Now tools and softwares that fall under this category are Python, R, MS Excel, SAS and SPSS. Now all these tools are required for you to pre-process and analyze the data. So apart from data pre-processing and analysis, there is a fair share of effort that's given for data exploration and visualization, and these are done even before you analyze your data. Now the commonly used data exploration and visualization tools are Tableau, ClickView, and of course you always have your MS Excel. So the next bucket that we are going to look into is when you have huge chunks of data. Now when you are collecting data on a real-time basis, you are going to be collecting data over every second, every minute. Now if you want to store all these data and pre-process it, the regular desktops or computing systems that you have might not be useful. So that's when you use parallel or distributed computing, where you distribute the work across different systems. The popular tools that are being used for big data are Apache Spark and Apache Hadoop. So in this course, we are going to be mainly focusing on tools that are required for data pre-processing and analysis, and in specific, we are going to look into Python. So let's look at the evolution of Python. So Python was developed by Guido van Rossum in the late 80s. At the National Research Institute for Mathematics and Computer Science, and this institute is located at Netherlands. So there are different versions of Python. The first version that it was released was in 1991, the second version was released in 2000, and the third version was released in 2008, with version 3.7 being the latest. So let's look at the advantages of using Python. So Python has features that make it well suited for data science. So let's look at what these features are. So the first and foremost feature of Python is that it is an open source tool, and the Python community provides immense support and development to its users. So Python was developed under the open source initiative approved license, thereby making it free to use and distribute even if it's for commercial purposes. The next feature is that the syntax that Python uses is fairly simple to understand and code. And this breaks all kinds of programming barriers if you are going to switch to a newer programming language. So the next important advantage of using Python is that the libraries which are contained in Python get installed at the time of installation, and these libraries are designed keeping in mind specific data science tasks and activities. Python also integrates well with most of the cloud platform service providers, and this is a huge advantage if you are looking to use big data. So if you are going to download Python from the website and install it, you will see that most of the scripting is done in shell. So there are applications that provide better graphical user interface for the end users, and these are taken care by the integrated development environment. So now let's see what an integrated development environment is. An IDE, as how it's abbreviated, is a software application. And it consists of tools which are required for development. all these tools are consolidated and brought together under one roof inside the application. IDEs are also designed to simplify the software development. This is very useful because as an end user, if you are not a developer, you might want all the tools available at a single click. So using an IDE will be very beneficial in that case. Also, the features provided by IDEs include tools for managing, compiling, deploying and debugging a software. So these also form the core features of any IDEs. So now let's look at what are the features of an IDE in depth. So any IDE should consist of three important features. The first is the source code or text editor. The second is a compiler and the third is a debugger. Now all these three features form the crux of any software development. The IDEs can also have additional features like syntax and error highlighting, code completion and version control. So let's see what are the commonly used IDEs for Python. The most frequently used are Spyder, PyCharm, Jupyter Notebook and Atom, and these are basically from the endpoint of the user depending on what he or she is comfortable with. So now let's look at Spyder. So Spyder is an IDE and it's supported across Linux, Mac and Windows platforms. It's also an open source software and it is bundled up with Anaconda distribution, which comes up with all inbuilt Python libraries. So if you were to work with Spyder, you don't have to install any of the libraries. So all the necessary libraries are taken care by Anaconda. So another important feature of Spyder is that it was specifically developed for data science and it was developed in Python and for Python. So this is how the interface of Spyder looks. You have the scripting window and you have other console output here. You have a variable explorer here. All these features we are going to be looking at in the next few lectures to come. The other features of Spyder includes a code editor with robust syntax and error highlighting features. It also helps in code completion and navigation. It consists of a debugger. It also consists of an integrated document that can be viewed within the Python interface or on the web. Another advantage of using Spyder is that it has an interface which is very similar to MATLAB and RStudios. So if you are a person who's already worked with these two programming languages and are looking to switch to Python, then the transition is also going to be seamless. So now let's look at the second IDE, which is PyCharm. So PyCharm is also supported across all OS systems, which is Linux, Mac and Windows. It has two versions to it. One is the community version, which is an open source software. The other is the professional version, which is a paid software. So PyCharm supports only Python and it is bundled up and packaged with Anaconda distribution, which comes with all the inbuilt Python libraries. But however, if you want to install PyCharm separately, then that can also be done. So this is how the interface of PyCharm looks. You have a very well defined structure for naming your directories and you have the scripting window here. So let's look at some of the features that PyCharm consists of. The first is that it consists of a code editor which provides syntax and error highlighting. Then it consists of a code completion and navigation feature. It also consists of a unit testing tool which will help the compiler go through each and every line of the code. It also consists of a debugger and controls the versions. So now let's look at the next IDE, which is Jupyter Notebook. So now Jupyter Notebook is very different from the earlier two IDEs in the sense that it is a web application which allows creation and manipulation of the codes. Now these codes are called notebook documents and hence that's how Jupyter gets its name, Jupyter Notebook. Now Jupyter is supported across all operating systems and it is available as an open source version. Now this is the interface of Jupyter. You can see that you have few cells here as an input. You also have some output. Let me just zoom in and show you how the interface looks. So here you can see some of the codes that is written. If you just scroll up and see, this is some narrative about whatever you've written. So Jupyter is bundled up with Anaconda distribution, but it can also be installed separately. It primarily supports Julia, Python, R and Scala. So if you look at the name Jupyter, it basically takes the first two letters from Julia, the next two from Python and then R. So that's how Jupyter gets its name as Jupyter. It also consists of an ordered collection of input and output cells like how we earlier saw, And these can contain narrative text, code, plots, and any kind of media. One of the key features of Jupyter Notebook is that it allows sharing of code and narrative text through output formats like HTML, Markdown, or PDF. If you are working in an education environment or if you would like to have a better presentation tool, then you can use these kind of output formats to present. So, though Jupyter consists of features that give a very good aesthetic appeal to it, it is deficit of the important features of a good IDE. So, by a good IDE, I mean it should consist of a source code editor, a compiler, and a debugger. And all three of these are not provided by Jupyter. So, the next IDE that we are going to look into is Atom. So, Atom is an open source text and source code editor, and it's supported again across all OS systems. It again supports programming languages like Python, PHP, Java, etc. And it is very, very well suited for developers. It also helps the users to install plugins or packages. So, one common drawback with all these text editors and source code editor is that these do not come installed with basic libraries of any programming languages. You have to install these kind of packages as and when you have a need for them. So, that is one major drawback for using any kind of text editor or a source code editor. But however, Atom does provide packages or libraries that are suited for data science and code completion or code navigation or debugging. So, you can install it. So, if you are a developer and if you want to code in a text editor environment, then you can go ahead with Atom, but you will have to install all these packages as and when you require. So, this is the interface of Atom. This is how it looks. It is a proper text editor interface. So, how will you choose the best IDE is an important question. So, it basically depends on your requirements, but it is a good habit to work first with different IDEs to understand what your own requirements are. So, if you are new to Python, then it is better that you work across all these IDEs, and there are several other IDEs out there. You can work with all these IDEs, see what suits you, and then take a call on which IDE to use. But in this course, we are going to be looking at Spyder. And that is primarily because it is a very good software that has been developed only for data science and Python, and it has an interface that's very, very appealing and easy to use for beginners. So, to summarize, in this lecture we saw what are the popular tools used in data science environment. We also saw how Python evolved and what are the commonly used integrated development environment. We also looked at what each of these IDE have to offer us and some of the common pros and cons of each of these. Thank you.